I spent the last decade spying on you and you and your families and really everyone in here. It's creepy, right? Yeah. It was all legal, it was all ethical, but it didn't feel right. But I'll tell you what I learned along that journey. We are all open books. Whatever illusion we have about our own privacy doesn't exist. Now, in these companies I looked after and ran, pulling information and collating and the rest, we're really good at finding almost anything about anybody. And that made us a target. It made me a target. And when I had organized crime, oligarchs, foreign intelligence coming after me, I realized just how vulnerable I was, my family was. And that's when I knew I had to switch sides. I had to try to solve this problem instead of being part of it. What I didn't know when I started to get into the problem was just how big it is. The cost of cybercrime, the cost of us not having privacy, is bigger than the entire illicit drug trade. It's massive. And it's that way by design. The internet was built to share information easily about all of us, quickly. And that was great 30 years ago. But now, criminality has moved online. Extortion, fraud, harassment, they've just transferred. We have new names for them. Cyberstalking, social engineering, right? Identity theft. Take identity theft. Most of us have heard about it, maybe know someone has been affected. It's the fastest growing crime in the US right now. Not fastest growing cybercrime, fastest growing crime. A third of us in this room will have our identity stolen at some point in our life. And all because we don't have privacy. Our private data is not private. Anyone here been on vacation recently, taking a picture? Hey, we're having a great time on holiday. Here's where we are, right? We'll be back soon. 4 out of 5 burglars today use the internet to search and find their targets and track them before acting. 4 out of 5. Again, the cost of us not having privacy. Online harassment has turned into a mental health epidemic. 2/3 of young adults are harassed online. 1/5 of young women are sexually harassed online. And it's only getting worse. When you think about what those comments can include when someone knows where she lives, where her kids go to school, or where she works out at 6 in the morning, it takes on an entirely different tact. Add all that together, and that's scary enough, I realize, but add to that the hacks. Think about pipelines, schools, hospitals, businesses, all the ones you read about, almost all of them are driven by the same thing, social engineering, which is just code for an online con scheme. Someone finds an employee at the organization, and they do what they do. They research their mark. They find out everything they can about them, and they get that employee to inadvertently do something that they shouldn't. And then they're in. Billions of dollars lost a year there because, again, we don't have privacy. Now, where is AI going to take this? AI is great in so many other ways. But one of the big problems with AI is it amplifies and accelerates our activities, our human behavior. And so I'll give you a case of where AI is not working. So imagine being this mom, getting a phone call from your daughter, tears, screaming, "I've been kidnapped." Oh my gosh, right? Imagine that daughter handing the phone to the kidnappers who are saying, "You've got 24 hours to transfer $1 million into a crypto account or your daughter will be killed." And if you even think about going to the police, she'll be killed immediately. The end. That actually happened. The mother contacted police. Turns out it was a hoax. Someone had used AI to create that whole script using no more than a laptop and $20 worth of software. Unfortunately, while AI is great in so many other ways, it's only going to amplify the challenges we have keeping our private information private in this day and age. So this sounds pretty rough. What are we going to do? Right? Is government going to come to the rescue? Trying, right? 11 states now have data privacy protection laws in the books. But one thing I think we all know is that certainly technology moves way faster than government can keep up. And sure, Prosecutors are doing what they do. They're finding the criminals. The regulators are making fines. And you'll see some record numbers out there. There have been $1 billion of fines levied so far. But it's a drop in the bucket. It's less than 1/3 of 1% of the overall economic impact. And it's not going to change behavior. So what do we do? The issue is, it's up to us. We're going to have to be the ones who change, all of us. There are 2,500 data brokers in the US who traffic in our information, right? Sell between each other, other companies. You can reach out to any one of them and demand your information be deleted, and they will. And there are tens of services that will do this online for you quickly and easily. We've got to start thinking differently about our own privacy. Social media. When was the last time you looked at the privacy settings on Insta or Facebook? It's probably been a while, right? Every year, police officers do a public service announcement saying, please don't put all this information about your kid who's going to school online. And a lot of folks say, well, what's the big deal, right? Really? So my kid's six, right? Their teacher, what they're into, hockey and ice cream, not a big deal. They're not even online, right? But you've got to think differently about privacy. Riley has an older sister, a teenager, who's online. And she is a target by a criminal. When that person finds out she's got a younger sister and says, I know where your sister goes to school. I know which grade she's in. I know where she has hockey practice. And I know she likes cherry ice cream. Unless you send me a nude photograph, I'm going to kidnap your little sister. Oh, this is very different. We've got to think differently about privacy. And it starts with awareness. When was the last time you Googled yourself to see what was out there and gone past page one, by the way, to see what's really there? That's the change we've got to make and the journey we're on. For all of technology's benefits, we're in a digital adolescence. There's a lot that's got to change and a lot that has to evolve. As we think about some of the biggest problems we face right now as a society and as individuals, privacy is the antidote. And I leave that antidote with you. Thank you.